Meeting a koala bear named Peter rather than Fred or John. Apart from meeting distant relatives who now live down the road instead of on the other side of the world, we discover Australia truly is the land of the car. Even the local bottle bank or alcohol store or off-licence is a drive-in. You pull up, wind down your window, order your beer, pop your boot and pay the attendant, who helpfully puts it into the car to save you even getting out. It is a land where everything is recycled and 4-litre cars fill up with gas for half the cost in England, while everybody complains at the expense. Whole roads are completely deserted as we walk the streets, devoid of anything other than air-conditioned cars, as it's too hot to walk. Pat offers his own car, but we're happy to wander off and explore, even locating a hairdresser where a little TLC is lavished on my Nepali bedraggled, vaguely blondish head. Outside the hairdresser's, I get to stroke my first ever kangaroo in a shopping centre where tickets are being sold to help the rescued roos. Only 8 months old and wrapped in blankets like babies with gorgeous soft fur coats and big ears. Water is on everybody's lips as bushfires rage and people die in the infernos that are constantly on the news. Black Saturday, 7th of February 2009, cost 208 lives, and donations and collections spring up everywhere to rebuild shattered lives. The flames engulf every treasured photograph, every childhood item, all gone forever, leaving behind only memories. The collections had started as we crossed the Nullarbor, with signs on garages and motels asking, "Are you heading for Victoria? Can you carry supplies and donations?" The whole country mobilises to assist Victoria, while Darwin drowns in water, Queensland submerges, and crocodiles swim in the streets. People lose everything in the same way, but thankfully retain their lives to rebuild. At the same time, radio stations are full of debate over water shortages and drought, of the need to install rainwater tanks in homes, rather than watching what little rain does fall swill down open drains. There's endless talk of the dying Murray River, which feeds Australia, and the cost of domestic water spiralling ever upwards, along with the water company's profits, which incrementally match each price hike. Settling into our new surroundings, guide dogs of South Australia track us down through our interviews in Perth and arrange a live outside broadcast with ABC Radio for the following morning at Pat's house. The breakfast news leads into the broadcast from beside a dismantled Bertha, needing new piston rings and exhausts. The reporter asks about our experiences across Pakistan and India, as the airwaves have been full of regular updates about attacks in Mumbai. He engages us with humour and questions about blindness, our experiences of Australia, the size of meals and everything in between. People who heard the interview asked us if we carried any weapons for self-defence due to the broadcaster's fascination with our route through Asia. Bernard merely answers, "Just a big smile," before going on to describe the sticker in our windshield. What you see depends mainly on what you look for. Even in countries people define as dangerous, most people are only going about their everyday lives, trying to make a living, looking after families. In England, the United States, or Pakistan, whether from China or Australia, children grow up all over the world with parents wanting them to have more than they did. It's the same everywhere, and if you look for the similarities, you'll soon find them. If you set out looking for differences, then they will shout out at you. Perhaps in the end we were just fortunate in our encounters. Perhaps our roads led us past people like ourselves, who happened to speak a different language. Over the following weeks, Bertha is fitted with shiny new exhausts sent from the UK and various other new engine parts like piston rings and gaskets to stave off further breakdowns. The mechanical problems are wearing us out, as Bertha is breaking down in more and more severe ways, while Bernard admits his knees are starting to feel their age with all the kneeling down. Pat, meanwhile, watches patiently as his drive becomes a workshop. Engine parts sit everywhere until the whole thing is sealed into oil tightness and pronounced fit for the next leg of the journey. Only then can Pat reclaim his drive from under tools and sheets of cardboard. We keep a promise to my eye surgeon, who had operated on both my eyes before leaving England and pronounced me fit to travel. The story had featured on BBC Radio 4's In Touch, the importance of regular eye tests. My diagnosis of glaucoma came quite by accident, after experiencing severe headaches for several days. Bernard had taken me to an optician to have the internal eye pressures checked, and the resulting readings indicated dangerously high levels. Normal range readings are below 20. My readings were 58. Rapid treatment reduced the pressure, followed by laser surgery and cataract operations. Fortunately, everything eventually settled down. It was through this experience that we came to understand that even for blind people, it's still important for them to have their pressures checked. In many ways, being unable to see makes the checking of eye pressures even more important, as you do not get any of the visual warning signals. If left unchecked, the internal pressures build, becoming so severe that the physical structure of the eye itself is threatened. Like many blind people who've lived with sight loss for so long, my days of regular checkups had stopped years ago. Thus, it was never discovered. Wandering into a local optician's, the receptionist is puzzled by a blind woman wanting an eye test, but the kindly optician understands the simple test I need, revealing internal pressures of 18 and 19, and so everything is fine. With Bertha now in one piece, and my eyes having been checked, I get a chance to get up close and personal with a 3-year-old koala named Peter at the Cleland Wildlife Park, in another one of the mysterious, touching coincidences, like the Australian number plate designated WA. Peter was my late husband's name, and Bernard considers the probability of meeting a koala bear named Peter rather than Fred or John or anything else. This Peter munches contentedly on eucalyptus leaves for the 5 or so hours he's awake each day. After standing in line for a childlike experience in a queue of adults with not a single child in sight, I find my arms are around him, feeling his really soft fur with very long, sharp claws digging into my shoulder. He's so cuddly and gorgeous, I do not want to let him go. As pictures are taken, I can hear all the people going, "Ah." Oh.